Workshop 2022. I have the distinct pleasure of introducing our keynote speaker, Larry Lessig, who is a professor of law and leadership at Harvard Law School. Among the legal scholars, Larry is known for many of his work over the past few decades, including Creative Commons, as well as advocating for the public domain, copyright reform, and campaign finance reform. And of course, many of you know that Larry is no stranger to the Wikimedia world. In fact, the Wikimedia projects have benefited substantially from a lot of scholarly and underground work that he has done over the past two decades. In 1999 and 2000, Larry wrote two papers with the subjects, The Law of the Horse, What Cyber Law Might Teach, and Code is Law. And these papers really revolutionized the way we approach policy questions related to software and code, and more broadly, the web. He taught us that with each line of code that we write, we make a decision about not only the code, but also fundamental issues such as freedom and privacy. And he anticipated some of the debates that we're still seeing today about regulating cyberspace when code is treated as law. In 2001, Larry founded Creative Commons, a nonprofit organization devoted to expanding the breadth of creative work that is available to all of us across the world to build upon and legally share. Those of you who have published paper in the Web Conference have benefited from the CC BY 3 license, which is one of the licenses that the Creative Commons has put out there. Today, of course, Creative Commons licenses are core to Wikipedia's ability to surface text and media to people across the globe. Larry, thank you so much for accepting our invitation and being in Wiki Workshop, and please take it from here.
Great, thank you so much. So I'm actually in the bowels of New York right now planning the revolution, and it was not gonna be a great space. I'm actually in like a painting room or something. Wasn't gonna be a great space to try to coordinate the technology of making a presentation properly. So I got up at the crack of dawn yesterday morning and I recorded what I wanna present to you today. And so I wanna present it, and it's about a half an hour long. And then I'm eager to take, you know, to turn that off and then come back for questions. So if it's okay, I'll just launch right into the recording, and let's hope that this is going to work. I'm going to turn my video off, and then I'm going to start with the recording.
So in 1999, I published the book Code and Other Laws of Cyberspace, and that book was quickly rendered as a meme, Code is Law. But actually, the point of that book was to tell a story about regulation generally. There was, I said, at the core of any regulation, the pathetic red dot, us. And we are regulated by many modalities of regulation. Law regulated us when the law says, do not speed. Norms regulate us when we say, for example, we declare our pronouns. Markets regulate us when they say, we'll pay you $15 an hour rather than $10. And most interestingly, architecture regulates us, the world we find it. My favorite MIT t-shirt, 186,000 miles per second. It's not just a good idea, it's the law. This idea that the way we find the world also gives us affordances and restrictions, also is itself a kind of regulator. And as applied to cyberspace, that regulator of architecture is code. But even more fundamental to the argument I was trying to make 23 years ago was that at the top of this structure of regulation was the law. Because the law, uniquely among these regulators, could reach out and affect the other regulators. The law, of course, regulated directly, but the law could be used to change the norms. Think about norms around smoking, to make it harder to engage in smoking. The law could regulate the market for cigarettes by, for example, taxing cigarettes. Of course, we subsidize tobacco, but put that aside, to make it harder to consume cigarettes. And the law could, as the Clinton administration considered, regulate the architecture of cigarettes themselves, reducing the nicotine in cigarettes to make the devices less addictive. The point then was that we need to recognize the mix of regulation and the mix can change, and that there was an incentive to change that mix, at least as it applied to cyberspace. The architecture of freedom that we celebrated so much at the birth of the internet, an architecture that gave us free speech and privacy and an open, neutral platform for innovation, would become, I argued, an architecture of control. So we needed to defend the code to sustain our values. Now, that point seemed to me obvious back then. Turned out it wasn't. First time I presented this argument to a group of technologists, a woman came up to me literally crying, saying, "I don't do politics." She wanted not to do politics. I had to insist. Her code was politics. Or when my book was reviewed by the New York Times, David Pogue wrote, "Plessig plays digital Cassandra and predicts that the internet will become a monster that tracks our every move, but that no one will heed his warning." He went on, "These discussions are thoughtful and measured, but the premise that frames them all is shaky. Plessig doesn't offer much proof that a Soviet-style loss of privacy and freedom is on its way. And unlike actual law, internet software has no capacity to punish. It doesn't affect people who aren't online, and only a tiny minority of the world population is. And if you don't like the internet system, you can always flip off the modem." Well, that's true. You could always flip off the modem. But the point was that I thought Pogue was missing something back then. And unfortunately, I think 20 years later, most people agree he was. Okay, that was the argument then. But the point now is different. I think we need to recognize that me and my lawyer-centric view was wrong about the dominant force in this architecture of regulation. It's not the law that's at the top. It's the market that's at the top. The market. Because the market, too, can affect these other modalities of regulation. The market regulates directly, of course, when the market says, for example, the cost of living is high in one place and not as high in another place, this cartoon that I saw when I was in Taiwan. Or the market could regulate the architecture of cyberspace or of the world to make it so that the infrastructure is more addictive. Or the market can regulate the norms that define how we exist and get along with each other to make it so we are more eager to spend our time online rather than with each other, as Sherry Turkle put so nicely in her book, Alone Together. Or the market can regulate the law itself by driving through campaign contributions or whatever other influences it might, the law to change to better serve the market. That was the example we saw with copyright, where Section 230 of the Communications Decency Act, setting up a notice and takedown provision, made it possible for platforms such as YouTube and many others to exist and to flourish. So the point together, if you think of all of these together, is that markets are regulating the regulators today, not democracy. And it's regulation through economic power. Now, focus on one critical example of this regulation, of the market in our world. The internet has a business model today, not everywhere, but it is dominant. That business model is advertising. Advertising has needs. It has the needs for engagement and data. It drives engagement to gather data. So how does it drive engagement? It drives engagement by hacking us. That might be an unfamiliar idea, but I think it's familiar if you think about the idea of body hacking. So think about food, not food like this, but food like this, or this, or this, or most importantly, something like this. I'm talking about processed food, food that is architected and designed. And in that perspective, behold the brilliance of this, the buffalo wings, which are the perfect mix of salt, sugar, and fat to make that food addictive. It's a miracle in the sense that Tide is a miracle because it's just a choice, a design choice by food scientists, by food architects, people who work to engage in a process of science to engineer food to overcome a natural resistance that we might otherwise have to this food so that we just can't stop consuming it. These scientists are exploiting evolution with the aim obviously, to make money. Now, for some people, this is perfectly harmless, but for other people, it is not. And they know, the companies know, that we can't resist what they offer us. That's what their scientists tell us. But the key to recognize is that they too, the companies, can't resist providing what they provide. Michael Moss, in this fantastic book, Salt, Sugar, Fat, tells the story of executives in the processed food industry who come to recognize the harm they are doing to the consumers who consume their food, and they choose to try to make their food more healthy. And then, of course, people don't want to eat the healthy version of their processed food. And so the market for those products declines, and then the executives are quickly kicked out, and the companies go back to their old ways, claiming the market made us do it. Okay, so that's body hacking. There's an equivalent in the internet context we should recognize as brain hacking. Tristan Harris, former Google engineer, now founder of the Center for Humane Technology, describes a similar science. It's the science of Silicon Valley. It's the science to engineer attention to overcome resistance, not of bodies, but of brains. The means are the same, exploiting evolution. Turns out we are just wildly responsive to random rewards, or turns out we just can't resist bottomless pits of content. And so by overcoming resistance, they are addicting us to engage in their platform. And then they collect the digital exhaust, the mouse droppings, to better understand what we want, not just by watching us, as they might sit by on the side of a road and count cars that go by, but by being active in poking and tweaking and asking us, rendering us vulnerable as users of this platform, reaching down, as Harris puts it, the brain stack to leverage our insecurity so that we reveal more. This is the business model of Facebook and Instagram. So that we do more, so that we reveal more, so that they see more, so that they can sell ads better. This is the world of surveillance capitalism, as Shoshana Zuboff describes it in her magisterial work with that title. And all this makes, they tell us, the internet possible. It gives us the internet, and it gives them a business. It's win-win from the perspective of the internet makers. Except that it's not. Because the unintended consequences, and let's really hope they are unintended, the unintended consequences of this surveillance are devastating. They're devastating for individuals, as we see an extraordinary rise in teen suicide, especially among younger people. But they're devastating for society, and particularly for democracy. Because as the AI that is embedded in these platforms selectively amplifies and suppresses content for the purpose of driving our engagement, as it elevates the crazy and suppresses the balanced, because it just turns out we are so susceptible to spreading and engaging with the crazy and not so much the sensible. Its choices, the choices of these AIs, have effects. And one effect in the context of democracy is to drive and spread hate. Because it just turns out, too bad for us, but it just turns out, because the best strategy for internet platforms to drive engagement in the context of democracy is to play out the politics of hate. If they can render us polarized and ignorant, then we engage more. If they can make us hate the other side, not just as different, but as enemies, we engage more. The politics of hate is the most profitable for them, even if it is wildly unprofitable for us. As Zeynep Tufekci puts it, companies are in the business of monetizing attention, and not necessarily in ways that are conducive to health or success of social movements, or the public sphere. Now, we can see this everywhere, but never so clearly as we saw in the extraordinary events of January 6th. In those events where people were rallied from around the country to travel to Washington, D.C. to stop the steal, we saw the manifestation of this infrastructure, not just the internet, but this infrastructure plus cable television, to make people believe what makes the platforms the most money. Now, the point is, these people on January 6th were not all crazy people. There were some, many, who had mental issues, but not all. Many of them were people who had just been led to believe that the world had conspired against them because the platforms had convinced them as much. Now, many people think it's just, you know, the uneducated, but as the Washington Post reported immediately after the January 6th events, over 70% of Republicans said they agreed with President Trump's contention that he received more votes than Joe Biden. Nor was this belief limited to those with lower levels of education. A majority of Republicans with college degrees in our sample said they believed the election results were fraudulent. As they go on, we asked voters whether they thought that, quote, millions of fraudulent mail and absentee ballots were cast, and whether, quote, voting machines were manipulated to add tens of thousands of votes for Joe Biden. Finally, we asked respondents reactions to the statements that, quote, thousands of votes were recorded for dead people. For each of these false statements, because of course those three statements are absolutely without any basis in fact or evidence. So for these three false statements, more than 50% of Republican respondents said that it was very accurate. Over 75% of Republican voters said that each one was very accurate or somewhat accurate. Only about 3% of Democrats assess these conspiratorial statements as very accurate. This is the product of a media infrastructure that places us into bubbles and speaks to us differently, acoustically separated bubbles, speaks to us in ways that feed what we want to believe rather than what's true. And that feeding has an effect, as we see so many believe what we all can see just is not true. The consequence is a business model that profits from harming us, from harming our democracy. Because what pays them weakens us. And it even weakens them. Extraordinary Facebook files revealed last year by Francis Haugen, the Facebook whistleblower, told a story of an extraordinary company, Facebook, a company that had fundamental values that were at the center of its business, values of privacy and integrity and safety. And more importantly, it had an extraordinary range of engineers, decent, honest people committed to these values, engineers who did everything they could to get the business to support and strengthen and defend these values. And they had plans, they had ideas, they had ways to make sure that the platform would be conducive to a healthy democracy, not constructive of the craziness that we saw. But what those engineers saw in the conflict between their recommendations to support privacy and integrity and safety was a business model that eroded those values because it was inconsistent with the fundamental commitment of that platform to drive engagement, to drive profit. Now, this is inevitable, we need to understand, especially in the age of AI. And think about an idea of instrumental rationality, the extent to which some entity or group is capable of being rational to some end, some particular end. And if you think across time and across the range of instrumental rationality, we can recognize that we humans have had a pretty good run for a long time. We're better at having an engaging instrumental rationality than cows, for example. I mean, maybe not ants and bees, but cows or sheep or not rats, but you know, you pick your animals that you think we actually are better at than they. But we need to recognize that corporations are better instrumental rational actors than we are. they can focus on their objective and achieve it more consistently, more reliably than we humans can. And even better than the corporations are the artificial intelligence infrastructures that get built into the corporations and into our lives. Now, each of these instrumentally rational actors purports or tries to control the one that's above them. We try through democracy to control corporations. We believe that our government has the rights and the capacity to control the corporations. And the corporations believe that through their management, they have the capacity to control AI. They think that they can set objectives, objectives of maximizing income subject to the need to be safe or healthy or maintain the integrity of information that they spread. But what we're seeing increasingly is a very different reality of control. Increasingly, it's AI that is controlling the corporations, as we saw with Facebook, or with a particular example in 2017 from Facebook, where it was revealed that Facebook's ads were offering a category of Jew haters because the AI had developed Jew haters as a potentially profitable category. Now, of course, there was no human at Facebook that picked the category Jew haters. No human would, but the AI did, because that was just what was maximizing its value. And the corporation, which had set up the management infrastructure to direct the AI, failed to control this particular innovation of the AI. Or corporations, of course, increasingly control us humans. This is a picture of super PAC spending, which has exploded since Citizens United, and more importantly, the DC Circuit case of SpeechNow, making it possible for unbelievable amounts of money to be concentrated in the hands of very few. In the last election cycle, the 10 largest super PACs spent more than half of the super PAC money that was spent. And the super PAC money has become the dominant form of spending in the context of political elections. This is a way for those with that money, primarily those with corporate interests, to leverage that power to control us. So in these three models of instrumental rationality, increasingly we should recognize it's the AI that will dominate all of them. And that in this dance for the corporations to regulate or control or condition the AI, we should see that the AI's signal that this is the way to maximize what you told me to maximize will increasingly dominate. So if in 2000, the lesson was code is law, I think in 2022, we should recognize business model is law. This is the slogan that should be our focus. Okay, so what's the relevance of this to Wikipedia? I think it's critically relevant because, of course, Wikipedia has a business model. But Wikipedia's business model is different from Facebook's. Because of core choices by the founders, Wikipedia was grounded in an anti-advertising context. The commitment not to sell ads was fundamental and incredibly important. Because what this means is that the core norms of Wikipedia, that it be free, that it be neutral, that it be well-sourced, would not be resisted or overridden by the consequences of an AI-driven focus on maximizing advertising revenues, but could be supported because the infrastructure of that business model would support these values. There was no systematic AI-driven force against these values because you can afford to speak the truth in the context of the Wikipedia ecology because falsehood is not more profitable. This is a business model. It's a business model that protects norms. And those norms we protect because we need to protect to derive the most extraordinary innovation on the internet, in my view, which is the ecology of Wikipedia. Now, this example, I think, is critically important and not remarked enough. What could it teach, for example, the news? if we think back to the time when the news served a uniting, integrating, and informative role in American society, what people call the broadcast democracy age of American democracy, when people were focused on the same story through a very small number of mediums, the business model of that news was not to maximize on the basis of driving engagement. The business model was simply to inform. But when the business model changed, even in cable television, we could see it change. What those platforms became was something fundamentally different. This is, I think, the scariest graph in American politics. This is a picture of the ideological content of the cable news networks. And what this shows is that circa 2000, Fox and MSNBC and CNN were basically ideologically the same. But over the period since 2000, we've seen a radical divergence as those companies learn that the business model of driving efficient engagement by their users is served best by polarizing and separating their base so that their base becomes committed and driven by the worldview they offer rather than committed or driven by the truth. Or what could the lessons of Wikipedia teach us for democracy? I mean, obviously, the business model for democracy is inherently for candidates to win. But the question we should ask is, at any cost? With micro-targeting a necessary means? Because, of course, we would have winners in elections without AI-driven micro-targeting, or maybe more accurately, AI-driven nano-targeting that can be targeting even different moods you and individual have, let alone people within your household or people within your neighborhood or people within your city or state or demographic. We would have winners in democracy without the democracy-destroying culture that this platform is creating. I think the lesson here should be that we need to choose the business model based upon the AI maximizing effect that we can see that business model will produce, and avoid the business models with inevitable externalities, with unavoidable externalities that we can see will weaken or harm our society. But so far, we haven't done that. So far, we've allowed these infrastructures to develop without any reckoning of what they will do for us and for our nation. I think our challenge is to do something now, before it is too late. Because one might question whether it is too late. And at least I increasingly believe it just might be too late. Okay, so let me try to draw the arguments of this talk together. Then, back in 2000, when I allowed this book to be summarized with the slogan, "Code is Law," what I meant to be saying is that we needed to choose our code, to defend our code, to defend the infrastructure that the internet would be to protect the values we thought important. We needed to choose our code to defend free speech and privacy and the free opportunity for innovation that end-to-end or network neutrality established. And that we needed to defend those values, maybe by regulating code, but certainly by regulating to assure that the environment of the internet would defend those values. That was the focus then. Because the most significant influence that would determine whether those values survived was the influence of code. Now the story is different. Now our focus should be the business model. Now we should say the business model is law, or maybe we should say business model eats law. And like with code, what that means is whether you need to choose the business model recognizing its AI-driven dynamic based on the values it supports and the society that it builds. That must be our commitment at least if we still can. Thank you for the chance to present this to you, and I'm eager to see the questions or the objections or the resistance or the ideas it might inspire. Thanks very much.
Thank you so much, Larry, for the presentation and sharing this with us. I believe, Isaac, you are moderating the Q&A. So if you would like to take it from here, please.
Sure. I'm going to actually pass the mic to Jimmy, who asked for a moment.
Yeah, just for a second. Thanks so much, Larry. This is it's great hearing from you and all this. Obviously, I agree completely with everything you said. And it's interesting to me to think about how much of my thinking was in the early days was influenced by your thinking, and how some of the decisions we made were consciously, if a bit vaguely, aware of the issues you're talking about. And others, I think, were just dumb luck that we went down one path instead of another, not realizing the depth of the implications of where it would end us up. And just the one thing I wanted to note, and I'm just going to, it's just a comment really, on some of the values that we strongly represent as Wikipedia and the Wikimedia movement. Some of them are very much intimately tied to that choice of business model. So we've always been very, very principled about freedom of expression. We don't bow to government demands to warp the truth that's in Wikipedia. And one of the reasons is we don't have these sort of very hard internal conversations that I assume people like Twitter or Facebook must have if they want to sort of support freedom of expression, but they say, well, we're going to get blocked in Turkey if this happens. We don't think, oh, we might get blocked in Turkey, so we better modify Wikipedia to suit the government there. We actually think if we stand up for it, our donors are going to be really happy with us. Our community is going to be really happy with us. Our business model actually incentivizes us to take a principled approach to these things rather than a page view based approach. So anyway, fantastic talk. I'm going to let others ask questions.
Thank you, Jimmy.
Yeah, so the first question is, what do you think about the Data for Good initiative for Facebook? And I guess I'd make that a little bit broader, that larger Data for Good movement.
Well, I mean, what I found most surprising in the Facebook files, I had the privilege of representing Frances Haugen for the very beginning of that fight that she was having to defend the ability to release that information, was the depth of goodness inside of the company itself, the engineers and the character of the engineers, and the number of exchanges that those Facebook files reveal where engineers are pushing hard to do the right thing and then get overridden by management, basically Zuckerberg or other similar sorts, was really inspiring. So I don't doubt the good faith or the good intent of movements like that. What I am skeptical of is that they can survive unless they've been insulated from the dynamics of the business model. So I want to hear that before I say whether I think it's going to be effective or not. I want to know exactly how they are insulated. What is the way in which they're not going to worry? And if that's, it's not like they couldn't do it, but until that's clear, I think we should remain skeptical.
Thanks. The next question is from Srijan. Srijan, would you like to ask yourself or shall I go?
Sure, I can ask. Thanks. Thanks so much, Larry, for your talk. I have a couple of questions. I'll ask one and then give chance to others. What are your thoughts on the arms race that's there between the malicious actors on social platforms that are trying to spread hate, propaganda, and all the bad things that you talked about? So these bad actors and the detection systems that these platforms have that are trying to catch them. And there's this arms race. And wanted to hear your thoughts on that and the role and responsibility that you feel that these platforms should have or have in terms of adapting to these scenarios or catching them.
Yeah, I think the Facebook files, and Jonathan Haidt just summarized this really powerfully in an article he published in The Atlantic. They reveal that the whole effort to suppress bad content is hopeless, that it only ever suppresses a tiny, tiny fraction of content that we should be worried about. And only in nations which have relatively well-known languages. So, you know, a huge amount of content on Facebook, you know, 90% of Facebook's audience is outside the United States. And a huge amount of that content in the context of the developing nations is in contexts where the platform can't even understand the content, can't even understand the language. And so the reposting in those contexts is a source of extraordinary hate. And, you know, obviously allegations of genocide have been pretty well established in some contexts. So I think that we have to focus not so much at the level of how do we identify the bad content and figure out what to do with it, but how do we undermine the incentive to be spreading the bad content or the structures that make it much easier. So Facebook discovered that if they just turned off the ability to repost automatically after two reposts, so you can't just simply click a button and repost content if it's been reposted twice before, you'd have to copy the URL and post it directly, that it could eliminate an extraordinary amount of misinformation that was on their platform. Simply by slowing the platform down to kind of human speed, you could bring humans into the process of making a better evaluation of whether they should be sharing that content. I think that's the more effective way to think about addressing these problems rather than imagining some super AI content moderator who's going to be able to figure out the subtle meaning of hate in these different environments.
Thank you. Thanks, Larry.
Thanks. Layla, you're up next. Would you like to ask?
Sure. So Larry, you talked about business model is law, and I'm thinking about the situation of the governments now who still believe and see profit in falsehood. And how does this focus in on business model is law going to play at the same time that these seemingly very strong governments are also involved in investing more and more in falsehood?
Yeah, I mean, so when I put this slogan out, it's going to cause, I'm sure, as much confusion as code is law can cause. So I don't take responsibility for the confusion. Maybe I should. But when I put that out, I don't mean to say that this is the only problem we should be focusing on. It's a particular problem that we should be focusing on right now in a world where antitrust has not yet addressed these extraordinarily powerful dominant platforms. And it's not clear it will in the next 10 years. It's still amazing to recognize that the last major antitrust case involving the internet, I was involved with. It was the Microsoft case, where for a brief moment, a nanosecond, I was a special master in that case. But the idea that that was the last time we had serious antitrust review of these platforms is astonishing. But in addition to the problem caused by the dominant power of the platforms, we have to worry about governments, and especially, again, governments in contexts where violence can be even more effectively delivered. And of course, the thing to recognize is the conjunction of interests between governments and these platforms. I mean, if the governments are using the platforms to spread their hate or to spread their authoritarian falsehoods, the platforms profit from that too, to the extent that the platforms at least are being compensated to do that. So I think that thing we need to encourage are locations on the internet we can reliably understand are locations of truth. Again, you know, Wikipedia is kind of unique in that. It is astonishing the number of my colleagues who 10 years ago would have been so skeptical of Wikipedia as a source of anything, but who now are open about the value of Wikipedia in establishing a kind of foundation for understanding and truth. And, you know, I'm eager, you know, I'm not trying to break your monopoly on truth, but I would like 1,000 Wikipedia-like locations to be out there where people can believe that they're stepping on something that has a foundation in reality as opposed to something that has foundation in the interest of either a corporation or the political interest of a government.
All right, I'll pass on to Bob now if you'd like to ask your question.
Yeah, thank you. Thanks, Isaac, and thanks, Larry. I was wondering, I wanted to poke your brain about the concept of recommender systems, because that's at the core of a lot of this, right? They nano-optimize to people and to the moods of people by the hour and minute and so on, but they also seem a necessity to even deal with all the content that's created all the time, right? So we can't really compare it to the cable news era, because they're wasn't this amount of content to be curated. Now it's just too much. So I'm I'm wondering to what degree, what are the options we even have? Because sure, we could try to turn off the recommender systems, but then we couldn't cope anymore. And to what degree are these just baked in consequences that don't need any malice even? They just come with the technical implementation of these systems. And do you think that the challenge needs to shift to actively work to keep the recommender systems usable? But where's the line? How can we say this is now bad versus good recommending?
Yeah, it's a great question. I mean, I think the first thing to recognize is, you know, for most of the history of humanity, we didn't actually have to deal with all information that was out there. Most of the information that was out there, the comments of people, the fights of your neighbors, all of that was invisible to you. And we got along pretty well. I mean, we could run democracies, you know, Europe, in Japan and in Korea and in the United States, we could run democracies quite effectively without everybody having access to all information. And now we've turned on the fire hose of all information. And now we're kind of trying to figure out how do we deal with it. And the challenge that I'm first identifying is we turned on the fire hose, but with a very poisonous incentive for the fire hose to be tweaked to drive engagement against the background of humans who, unfortunately for us, are turned on more by outrage and hate than are turned on by poetry and well thought out arguments. You remember, I don't want to get this too far as a diversion. Okay, so you're right. I think that even in the best world, we're going to have structures of recommendation engines. And I think the most we can do is first monitor the incentives of the recommenders. Like, are you a recommender? Like, I don't think there's any problem to being like a right-wing recommender or a left-wing recommender or a recommender for like, good food or whatever. But you might be concerned when you understand that the recommender has a system of incentives that is driving them away from recommending the best right-wing content as opposed to the right-wing content that's paid for by X or Y. We at least need to understand that. So the structure of incentives is number one. And number two, we have to recognize that that it's a very complex system that we have implemented, and we need lots of data to understand the sensitivity of any of these architectural choices to the reality that they produce. So transparency about the data and how it's actually mattering would be extremely important. Of course, the platforms have resisted so far the call of researchers to have access to their data, to be able to make an evaluation of, like, you know, what is the consequence really of turning on the repost all the way up to 10 different reposts? Like, what is the real consequence for that? Instead, they have to rely on their own researchers. And of course, the consequence of the Facebook files is I'm sure Facebook is going to do a lot less internal research because they're afraid of those data being revealed to the public. Well, somebody needs to be doing that research. And I obviously support the idea of making the data accessible to researchers who can be making the evaluation so that we can learn which architectural choices against the background of certain business models are safer than others, because I don't think we know that right now.
Thank you. The next question comes from Octi. Octi, I'll give you a chance if you want to ask it yourself. Otherwise, I'll proceed.
Okay. Hi, yes. This is Octi. Thanks for the opportunity and a great talk. I was wondering, also since Jimmy is here, since the start of, when I started using Wikipedia, I always wondered why we don't have like a tiny box on each Wikipedia article with an ad in a very, as harmless as possible way, verified. You know, if, for example, if you listen to NPR, they have these tiny bits of selected of, commercials, and they also, whenever there's the news is about those supporters, they declare it. So I feel like not an expert in this space, I'm a computer scientist, but I feel like there could be a way in theory to make the business model less harmful. And I was wondering what your thoughts would be. And if the answer to this is yes, it's possible, then wouldn't it be possible to have regulations that every single ad supported social media platform or internet platform should follow these strict regulations so that they don't end up being so harmful.
Well, I think that you're pointing to NPR as a really important recognition because, I mean, in fact, there have been lots of claims that NPR's acceptance of sponsorship by certain entities like oil companies and the like has affected their reporting, that the managers, in the context of deciding which things ought to be covered, can't help but worry about whether the things they cover might affect their ability to get sponsorship in certain areas. So, you know, even though I think our perception of NPR, at least in the United States, at least among us liberals, is that it's a good site, it's also got its integrity or corruption problems. And you know, I'll let Jimmy speak for Wikipedia, but I would be terrified with the idea of Wikipedia embedding any advertising dimension into what they're doing. It's not because it's disruptive to the reader. I mean, of course, you could frame it so it's just a tiny little box to the side. But the question is, like, you know, as the middle managers of Wikipedia are trying to figure out how to maximize revenue for advertising, what decisions do they make? What kind of recommendation decisions do they make? Or when they tell the AI that, you know, you might develop inside of Wikipedia, here's one of our maximizing dimensions, what does the AI do? I mean, I think all of those are very difficult choices to do and to get right. But then the third point is, let's imagine you came up with the best possible structure of integrity for advertising. Why not just impose it on all other sites? Well, I do think we need to think about regulating targeted advertising in certain contexts of other platforms. But in the United States, that's going to be extremely difficult because the First Amendment has been raised as an absolute bar to this kind of regulation. A decade ago, my friend Eugene Volokh was hired by Google to write a paper that basically said algorithms are speech, and so therefore you can't regulate algorithms, you can't muck about with that at all because that's core political speech. I think the argument's crazy, but if you asked, you know, what's the stand of courts today, most courts would take something closer to Eugene's view than to my view. And so I think the United States, we're going to see a lot of constitutional limitations to the ability of the government to deal with these questions. You know, I've been saying we ought to be regulating the business model. People say there's a constitutional right to your business model. I think that's crazy, but, you know, I think a lot of things are crazy and the courts seem to think differently. But I think that there is a chance in Europe in particular, which has taken a lot of aggressive steps, again, I think pushed by the Facebook files, to experiment with different kinds of regulations. And I'm hopeful that if Europe trips on the right kind of regulations that minimize the poison, at least in the context of democracy speech, that other countries will find a way to integrate it into their own regulations, the First Amendment notwithstanding.
Thank you, Sam.
Jimmy, if you're still here, did you want to make a response as well? All right, I will go on to the next question then. It's coming from Matt. And he asks, are you able to speak to Wikidata's use of CC0 licenses and the commercial appropriation of CC0 licensed metadata and applications such as Google Knowledge Graph?
I'm a little bit hesitant because I don't know the facts well enough. My own view is, you know, data is a complicated licensing space because of the difference between the Europeans and the Americans about whether the underlying resource can be licensed at all. And my own view is very libertarian about it. We ought to be enabling as much data to be usable as possible. And to the extent there are privacy concerns, we should not be looking to copyright law or licenses to be dealing with the privacy concerns. I think there is an essential need for privacy regulation and an essential need for data misuse regulation. But that's it. But that, in my view, is just independent of this crude hammer of copyrights. So my general bias is in favor of CC0 for as much as possible. And you know, if it helps commercial entities do commercial things, then I think that's, you know, in a Richard Stallman sense, that's what freedom means.
Thank you. Pablo, you're up next. Would you like to ask your question?
Thanks, Isaac. Thanks for the talk. So speaking of business model, could a different form of monetizing the internet? And when I say by monetizing, I mean quantifying value, like that value that will be maximized by artificial intelligence or by a recommended system. A way of quantifying value rather than clicking behavior that is not based on creating clicks, but in a more sophisticated forms of value could have a positive impact on the dynamics of web platforms?
Well, I think that, you know, there's been a long tradition of trying to think of these alternative structures. I think Corey, Dr. Rose, Woofy, early on was like imagining a way of rewarding behavior that wouldn't be directed, wouldn't be linked to something like clicking. And I think what we ought to be committed to is the idea of experimenting with lots of different ways to try to do that, to monetize and to recognize support for this infrastructure. We should also be open to a very traditional answer, which is public support for infrastructures, which, you know, the nature of public support for infrastructures, at least ideally, obviously governments are not always good at this, but is to remove the support from the question of the corruption of the integrity of the platform. And so I would be in favor of trying all of these and looking for all of these, but in a world where we have transparency to understand how in fact these different regimes are affecting behavior and the spread of information.
Daniela, you're up next. Would you like to ask?
Oh, yes, thank you. Sorry for the noise, there is a storm outside, but. So I wanted to ask, the market and the law, as you said, are powerful forces that are able to profoundly influence the evolution of the internet, and sometimes in good ways, for example, by financing some innovative technologies or protecting the rights of the users, but sometimes in bad ways. So projects at Wikipedia and Wikidata show that it is possible to have a sense of self-regulation where we also have the community as a very powerful force that is able to in some way interface with the other forces and understand itself by itself to drive its own destiny. So I wanted to ask, in your opinion, what is the best way to support and incentivize such a model where the community, and how can we make sure that such model can survive and can thrive in the current environment?
Yeah, I think it's an incredibly important resource to deploy and to rely on. But we need to be constantly skeptical about the content of the quote community, because sometimes communities can become themselves corrupted so that interested parties populate the community with, quote, community members who then affect the force of those interested parties as opposed to just the community. So I think that as long as that dimension of awareness is there, I think it's a very valuable thing to add. So I apologize. I thought we were going to 15:15, and I've got a cab outside honking. You might have just heard the honking. So I have to flee.
No worries. Thank you so much, Larry.
Okay, great. Thank you, guys.
Thank you.